como los ejemplos que nosotros dimos, como que en Puerto Rico también hay diferentes
where there are different revolutionary groups in Puerto Rico that are ready to use arms when that becomes necessary. Puerto Rico is being prepared for revolution, armed revolution.
Me amarran las manos, me callan la boca, me pegan de palos, pero no me tocan. Saben que he aprendido la sucia verdad, que a mi Puerto Rico lo van a explotar. Puerto Rico,
Lolita Lebron, a controversial figure on the Puerto Rican political scene, is known above all for her armed attack, together with three Puerto Rican compatriots, on the Congress of the United States, the 1st of March, 1954. Born in Lares, the cradle of Puerto Rican nationalism, the daughter of workers, from childhood, she absorbed the rebellious spirit of Pedro Albizu Campos against the oppressive structures of foreign domination. Raised at the same time in the Christian tradition, she would combine her religious belief with a revolutionary fervor unique in the history of the Americas. Pardoned in September 1979, after 25 years of confinement, characterized by an unshakable personal commitment to her patriotic ideals, Lolita Lebron has immersed herself anew in the struggle for the dignity and independence of her homeland.
You're from Lares, aren't you?
Yes,
I'm from Lares, where the cry of independence was given, that's right. How did you get from Lares to the Congress in Washington, D.C. in 1954? Well, as you might imagine, following the path of freedom. Yes, but the development of your political awareness, more or less, how did it start? Well, the experience of being a Puerto Rican woman from working class families where there was so much repression and so much oppression. From there, I developed a capacity, a sense of the needs, of how to resolve the problems of the community. And above everything else, through Don Pedro Albizu Campos, having heard from him about the Ponce massacre and other events in the history of the struggle for national liberation, things that one always heard about. Did you know Don Pedro personally? Personally, no. However, when people ask me if I knew Don Pedro, I always say yes, because I don't believe I have ever known a better human being than Don Pedro, unless it was my mother. Do you come from a large family or small? We could say I come from a large family. Basically farmers? Yes. Now, there are many professionals now. But my father was from a landed family, although for a variety of reasons, he had to separate himself from that social state due to marital difficulties. He became more of a laborer. What were the circumstances in which you joined the Nationalist Party? Well, I swore allegiance to the fatherland under the guidance of Don Pedro Albizu Campos. I was living in New York at the time. Coming back to the Nationalist Party, can you say something about the ideology? The ideology of the Nationalist Party derives from the nationalist roots set down by the father of the country, Don Ramon Emeterio Betances. father, too, of our Declaration of Independence. We stand, therefore, for the right to our own nationality. Nationalism in Puerto Rico represents the purest essence of the Puerto Rican nation. Was this a socialist independence? Or just independence? That's where you're mistaken. Don Pedro Albizu Campos is a man of such human and intellectual dimension that he could not conceive of a fatherland without social justice. Moreover, Don Pedro was one of the leaders of the social struggle in Puerto Rico in the sense that he was the one who represented the workers in the cane strikes in the 1930s. Nevertheless, Don Pedro's idea was first and foremost the need to free Puerto Rico from the presence of foreign invaders and colonizers like the United States, and that once a republic had been created, the people of Puerto Rico would determine and define their political philosophy according to the democratic will of the people. Not like other peoples who are trapped in a neo-colony. We've never believed in the freedom that exists in Latin America and other parts of the world, what we call neo-colonialism. We believe it's impossible to be really free if there's no social justice. We do not consider independence in itself to be liberation, but we call it liberation because it's the principal yoke we bear, the presence there of an invasion of a foreign power in Puerto Rico. Clearly, this is the most important basis for liberation, the establishing of people's independence. You were speaking earlier about your trip to Cuba, and apparently you were quite impressed. Is it your understanding that in order for there to be social justice in Puerto Rico, it will be necessary to follow more or less the path that Cuba pursued in 1959? I believe that Puerto Rico will have its own Puerto Rican republic, that every situation is itself unique, that we can learn much from Cuba, and that we must fight, should it be necessary, as it's very obviously is. As for what kind of republic to establish in Puerto Rico, I believe it should be a socialist republic. But we also have a right to contribute not only to the definition of socialism, but to the practice of socialism as well, with our own ideas. For example, socialism in Cuba is different from partisan socialism in Puerto Rico. I really like Cuba's socialism. Socialist currents in Puerto Rico are conflictive, too conflictive. This is something we have to work on. If we can become like Cuba in a social and intellectual sense, that would be magnificent, for Cuba is a country that has developed enormously in the areas of education, health, the economy, many areas. It's a lesson for the entire world. Yes, I'm very favorably impressed. I can even say I was overwhelmed by Cuba. But what I most liked about Cuba was the humanity that emanates from the people, their sense of collectivism and family, the education that's so perceptible there, the intellectual development of the children, the sense of community, the recognition of work and of the worker. Cuba is a nation of workers, a vanguard nation with its own politics. Cuba has a politics quite its own. There are many things in Cuba that we could call traditionalist, like that great sense of honor Cubans have toward women. There are many things there we do not find alien because there's so much a part of us. Indeed, we're exceedingly proud of Cuba. Changing realities completely, what impressed you the most when you returned to Puerto Rico for the first time after being away 25 years? What impressed me the most? Yes, because obviously in 25 years many things changed. In Puerto Rico? Yes. Puerto Rico, as I already said, gives the appearance of progress. But that in itself must have been quite impressive, extremely impressive. I recognize that progress. But in trying to penetrate it, one finds it empty. Nevertheless, we could make use of it for the Republic of Puerto Rico, since we wouldn't have to build many houses, because we already have a lot. We have roads, great physical beauty, architecture. There are many buildings. The country's beautiful. It's always been a beautiful country. And if we look at it, it was more beautiful in times gone by when agriculture hadn't suffered so much, for we have a lot of cement, much housing, many lights, many cars, many industries, many corporations. The people look good. They seem to be healthier, too. Puerto Rico gives the impression that you're in the United States, that you're in New York. That's impressive, but you know, it doesn't impress me very much because I look to the roots of things and I see that this progress has done us much harm. We could also say that there's something positive in this progress, but it isn't used at all positively. Rather, it's negative, because all stimulus for the people of Puerto Rico to be themselves has been cut off. It's a country paralyzed, excepting, of course, for the liberation movement. So, progress aside, you feel that basically the condition of Puerto Rico hasn't changed since the time when you left. No, not in the most essential things. The colonial situation hasn't changed. Now it's really difficult. It's more difficult now than ever before to free Puerto Rico. In what way? A people with so much material comfort. It's difficult to tell people they must give up much of that comfort and that they must make sacrifices. Before, it wasn't that way because the people were so needy. They had no food, they were sick. It's not like that now. But you also seem to give the impression that this progress doesn't really belong to them, in the sense it's really an imported progress. If we were free, we would have that progress and something better, I believe. We could arrive at that. What I'm saying is, the price we've paid for that transitory material progress. We're not interested in that. Our interest is to see the country free, sovereign, and independent, forging its own destiny, growing, developing, a country with national dignity. And I don't know where that national dignity is, if not, for example, in these comrades who are now in prison, in all those others who have died and are buried, in all those who are moved to bring about the independence of Puerto Rico, and who do so with honesty and sincerity. That's national dignity. One of the things that has most impressed me about you is the way you've been able to keep faith in God, that Christian faith, after all that you've, I can't even imagine what you've experienced. Did you always have that faith, or did you acquire it while you were in the United States? My faith has grown immensely. Nonetheless, when we attacked the capital of the United States of North America on the 1st of March, 1954, I began my message to the world in this way, before God and the world. So it is seen, or should be seen, that I had faith in God, that I recognized God above all things. Later, while in prison, that faith grew more, because I was subjected to many difficulties of life, which I believe, I am certain, in order to survive and survive with dignity, with the firmness of one's principles, with unbreakable willpower, one needs something superior to a human being, because we're not invulnerable. We don't have all the answers. And we depend on God. We don't want to depend on anything that denigrates us, rather on that which elevates us, which is God alone. It was mentioned that you were exceedingly busy in Puerto Rico. In what kinds of activities have you been involved? For me, let it be clear. Politics embraces everything and contains everything. This is the politics I know, that I conceive, in which I am active, politics that I define, that no one defines for me. I'm working in politics because I'm in touch with the people. I'm learning from the people. I'm taking their pulse. I visit with them, they visit me, we have dialogues with students, with professors, I speak at universities and schools, I talk with families, they visit me in my home. My house is always filled with people visiting when I'm not away on some engagement. My talks are informal, as we're conversing now. They're not based on books and university degrees and such things. For that, there are books and newspapers and universities with which I need not be concerned, thank God. But I have my own school developed through my social interaction with the world. And it's from this school, plus what God has given me directly, that I speak to the world. The world, in turn, speaks to me from its life experience, and all this complements itself in giving us important insight into life and the times we're living, as well as into what one can contribute to the solution of national and international problems. But in Vieques, for example, have you had any contact with the struggle in Vieques? Yes. I've had contact with the struggle in Vieques to a degree. I've met Zenon. I've met Iliana. I've met many of those involved. We have a very distinguished nationalist woman in the Vieques struggle, Isabel Rosado. I had the great honor to take part in a protest demonstration in Vieques, a demonstration that took place the day the Navy was going to conduct maneuvers there, and the United States had to suspend those maneuvers for 4 hours. Do you remember? I went there. I marched. I also went down to the edge of the sea where the little fishing boats were. It's part of my struggle. It's part of militancy. Vieques is a municipality of Puerto Rico, as I already explained. All our efforts to achieve liberty are done for all Latin Americans and for the entire world. It's a delightful endeavor. It's filled with great suffering, but it's nourishment, it's life, it's joy, it's a celebration. Why, I've suffered a great deal, but never have I let the empire see me fallen, because I've never let myself fall. I've held back my tears. I don't cry. If I wish, I could cry for the rest of my life. But I don't, and I won't, and that's the end of it. I'm happy. Happy because I'm fulfilling an obligation. That's what I want to project into people's hearts. Are you affiliated with any political party in Puerto Rico? No. But you know that I'm Puerto Rican nationalist. I have sworn an oath. I'm a member of the Puerto Rican Nationalist Party, but I almost always act as a nationalist without representing the Puerto Rican Nationalist Party. My view of nationalism is too universal within the independence cause. Parties are always compromising themselves with something, or with other parties. I'm not beholden to anyone. I am, however, committed to the nation of Puerto Rico. I swore allegiance to the flag and to the fatherland. I have a party, and I'm not going to violate the precepts of that party, nor am I going to give them any cause to expel me from the party, because the only way I can be expelled is by being disloyal. And he who fights for the cause, within the principles of the cause, is never disloyal. Those principles are very much alive in me. In answer to your question, then, I'm a Puerto Rican nationalist. I belong to the Nationalist Party of Puerto Rico. I'm not representing them now, but I believe it would not bother them were I to say that I am.
¿Usted cree que se tiene que dar
Do you feel there must be a liberation struggle here in the United States too? Certainly. A liberation struggle in the United States is irreversible. It has to come. I imagine the United States will have to be stopped if it doesn't destroy itself first. It's falling. It has almost nothing. When human beings and nations lose the fortitude of their spirit, they go to pieces. All empires have fallen, and this empire is headed for its final demise. Perhaps some good fortune will produce someone who can do something here, but they don't even have a leader. This country has no leadership. Do you think that's a problem in Puerto Rico as well? In Puerto Rico, there are people who can be leaders. Now, the ones you see every day in the press and those who think they govern the country, these are not leaders. There are no leaders in the government of Puerto Rico because Puerto Rico doesn't have a government. In Puerto Rico, there are marionettes of the United States. They respond to the mind of the United States and the interests of the United States. But as to whether the Puerto Rican independence movement has leaders, I think it does, that it could have leaders. Do you feel that they are the ones who will carry out the struggle, or will there have to be others? Others? Other leaders? Is the leadership there now?
Está la semilla fuerte.
The seed is strong.
Esos líderes que hay. Por ejemplo,
Maria Beltrán Torres. She's a magnificent leader.
Porque para ser un pueblo libre no se necesita
Parliamentary leaders are not what is needed to light the fire. We're tired of all that, of constantly sitting around and talking in meetings and passing resolutions, of trying to find the meaning of this term and that, every week, every month, every year, talk, 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 talk. A movement that decides to do whatever has to be done to rise up and paralyze the U.S. presence there. To paralyze everything. That's the movement that's going to bring independence to Puerto Rico, and that movement is here. And what about the armed forces of national liberation? Do you see them as trying to do basically what you tried to do in 1954? Yes, I do. Puerto Rican nationalism adopted the line of armed struggle.
Y a través de la persuasión
through persuasion
de la asamblea constituyente del pueblo
and a constituent assembly of the people.
Es decir, que el Partido Nacionalista
that is the Nationalist Party
no elimina
which is a movement
de su línea de lucha
born in Puerto Rico does not eliminate from its line of struggle the right to arms.
Y cuando se han tenido
and when it has been necessary to use them
si tuvieran que volver a usar, y hay que usarlas,
they've been used
y hay que usarlas ahora.
Should it be necessary to use them again and it is necessary and it's necessary now they'll be used. The only difference with the armed forces of national liberation is that they have a new strategy
con las armas.
The strategy of the Nationalist Party was slightly different.
Pero ellos son para mí nacionalistas.
But for me, they're nationalist.
Que la circunstancia del momento en que ellos bien requieren,
present circumstances require that they operate clandestinely, then that's what they must do.
Yo sé que tú pones los ojos un poquito
I know this upsets
serio.
People.
Es un poquito
that's
difícil
a little
entender
hard
esto.
To understand.
Pero tenemos que dar gracias a
but
Dios
we must thank God that this movement is there.
Yo sabes. Sí. Y yo espero que se fortalezca.
I hope that it gains strength. That it grows. And this will be the movement that carries Puerto Rico to its national liberation. I, for my part, am going to help them in every way I can. I'm going to form part of the movement, and I'm speaking as a woman alone, alone. Just imagine how nice it would be if I refused to recognize them, if I refused to shake their hand, if I refused to join them, knowing that I spent 25 and a half years in prison, And that when I went to prison, people wanted nothing to do with me. So great was their fear, they called me names. Even the Puerto Ricans called me every evil thing you can think of. They didn't have the courage to stand up to the empire. In some way, the empire must know that every day it has to be afraid, because there's an active challenge to it. And they represent that challenge. And the people are with them, but they're still fearful. That fear the Puerto Ricans cannot shake. What do they fear? The atomic bomb, starvation, that the United States will come and bomb them and destroy everything there. But nothing like that is going to happen, because the United States won't be able to do that. Their international prestige is almost non-existent. They'll be forced to respect Puerto Rico when Puerto Rico rises up against the empire, and we hope that we'll be the ones to rise up, which is the object of these exemplary actions, like the example that we ourselves gave. For there are different revolutionary groups in Puerto Rico that are ready to use arms when that becomes necessary. Puerto Rico is being prepared for a revolution, armed revolution. We're going to make an armed revolution. What we're doing now is giving the United States a little time to see what course they choose.
Me amarran las manos, me callan la boca, me pegan de palos, pero no me tocan. Saben que he aprendido la sucia verdad, que a mi Puerto Rico lo van a explotar. Se libertará de manos muy sucias, carroña mortal que abusa a mi pueblo, que nos quiere comprar. Hay cuatro valientes que no cansarán, los han encerrado y los quieren matar. Si matan a uno, otros 100 nacerán, llevando la lucha por la libertad. Puerto Rico, te llevo en mi sangre, pueblo que un día se libertará de manos muy sucias. Carroña mortal que abusó a mi pueblo, que nos quiere comprar. Hay cuatro valientes que no cansarán, los han encerrado y los quieren matar. Y si matan a uno, otros 100 nacerán, llevando la lucha por la libertad.